But let's give a house welcome to Dennis DeGrasse.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Wow. I guess I get that except beside instead of money.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's all right. Praise the Lord. Money isn't everything. Can buy everything with it, but it isn't it. Speaking of that, I have a book in the back there that I'd like you to buy. Actually, if you want one, just for a donation, just take one. If you don't have any money and you want one, as long as you'll read it, just take it. Amen. The idea is I don't want to carry any books back out to the car with me when I go home. So please take advantage. It's a good book. It's a good book to teach you, or if not you, someone you know, about the Holy Spirit, how to be filled with the Spirit, how to walk in the Spirit. And some people, churches even use it to teach classes with, like new beginners class and things like that. So take advantage of it. It's just a good resource. I want to talk to you about offense. Now, I don't mean the kind of offense that they're talking about building between us and Mexico. I'm talking about offense, like being offended, taking offense, causing offense, and how damaging offense can be. In 2 Kings, we see this great story of God's love, even for Gentiles, you know, and it's a story of a man named Naaman, and it tells us, it really shows us how to deal with offense. I've discovered God is really not too politically correct, and that very often God will use offense to deal with us. Have you noticed that? Jesus was quite often offensive in his ministry to people, the way he said things, the way that he did things. And sometimes it seemed as though he went out of his way to make it difficult for people to follow him. And God oftentimes does that, and he'll allow things to come into our life, or he'll, you know, bring us into relationships sometimes where people rub us the wrong way. Have you ever been rubbed the wrong way? You know, I like to camp. I don't get to do it often, but you know, one of the cool things is to watch somebody take a block of wood and a stick and a shoestring and start a fire with it, you know, and that's from friction. Friction causes a lot of heat in life, doesn't it? And especially with each other, there can be friction that can cause things to smolder. And so offense is something we have to live with and something we need to learn to deal with and how to properly handle it, and sometimes is it appropriate even for there to be an offense. So let's look a little bit at the story of Naaman. It's in 2 Kings and chapter 5. And take me a second to get there in my handy dandy. All right. So the Bible says Naaman was a captain of the army of Aram. We talked about this King Aram, this kingdom, the Arameans we call them today, but in our last session when we were dealing with breakthrough. And so here was a man that would have in some sense been an enemy. This king would have been an enemy of Israel. They at times were at odds with one another, and he was a great captain. He was very respected by people, even by his king. And if you had leprosy, that was sort of a pretty devastating disease to have, because it meant you could have no social contact with people. You were literally cut off. In Israel, if you had leprosy and you were going where people were, you had to yell out, unclean, unclean. Can you imagine having to say that as you walk down the street about yourself, you know, and that I'm unclean, don't come around, I've got a contagious disease. And I'm sure they had no trouble getting into places. Lines would just vanish before them. And so if you went to Disney World and yelled unclean, you could probably be the first on every ride, maybe the only one on every ride. And so here this man was a valiant warrior, but a leper. And the Bible says that there was a little captive girl there, a little Israeli girl that was a servant in the house. But apparently she must have had a great love and affection for this man, because when she told her mistress, she said to her mistress, I wish that my master were with the prophet who's in Samaria, then he would cure him of his leprosy. And so Naaman went and told his master, telling the, you know, the story of what he'd heard. And so the king of Aram sent a letter down to the king of Israel. And along with the letter, he took 10 talents of silver, and 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 changes of clothes. Now, I don't know how much all that would amount to, but it sounds like a small fortune, doesn't it? And this was how valuable it was to him to get healed. And he brought the letter to the king of Israel, and he said, "As this letter comes to you, behold, I've sent Naaman my servant to you, that you may cure him of his leprosy." The king was like, "Wow, really?" And he says, "Who am I that he was going to send this man to me? He's just trying to start a war with me, looking for any excuse to get into a war with me." And but one of the servants heard the story and said, "Look, send him over to Elisha." Or Elisha heard the story and said, "Send him over to me, and I'll take care of him." The Bible says Naaman came with his horses and his chariots, and he stood at the doorway of the house of Elisha. Elisha sent a messenger to him saying, "Go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh will be restored to you, and you will be clean." Well, you know, that's really not a hard task, is it? But the Bible says he was furious, and he went away, and then this is what he said, "Behold, I thought." You know, sometimes our thoughts can get us in trouble, can't they? You know, have you ever had thoughts about how something was going to happen? And he said, "I thought he will surely come out, stand in front of me, call on the name of his God, and wave his hand over the place and cure the leper." So in his mind, he had this picture all set up the way that it was going to be. But it didn't turn out that way. And see, you know, that can be very offensive to some people because they're so fixed in their mind. Now, maybe that's the way they did it in his land. Or it could be that he just imagined that that was the way that it was going to happen. And I've discovered that very often, in fact, never does God do things the way that I think that he will. And even when he's given me prophetic words through other prophetic ministries about things that he's going to do in my life, it never turns out the way that I thought it would. Are you with me? Have you ever had those experiences where, you know, you get a word, you get a promise, you have a dream, you have a vision, and man, you've got it all mapped out. And usually it ends up in a disaster, first of all. But then somewhere along the line, something begins to happen, and you wake up one day and you realize, wow, this is what God was talking about all along. You see, and so Elisha became offended at God and offended at the prophet because it didn't come the way he thought it should. And then he said, "Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?" So he turned and went away in a rage. Now, oftentimes when we get offended, that's the next step. We can become bitter. And when we become bitter, we can take things into our own hands and do it our way. Well, if that's all it's going to take to get me clean, I'll just go back to one of our rivers are much more clean than this dirty Jordan. And I'm just going to go there and get it done my way. But his servants, it's amazing how this man was loved by his servants, because his servants came near and spoke to him. Now, you know, can you imagine how tricky that would be to speak to this guy who is a warrior? Probably had a long sword by his side. He's pretty ticked off at God. He's mad at the man of God. He's mad at the whole situation. But yet they had enough love for him in their heart that they were willing to take a risk to approach him. And they said, "If he asked you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he says to you, wash and be clean?" So he listened to them and he humbled himself, and he went down and dipped himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man of God, and his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. Now that's a pretty powerful story. And oftentimes God will set up situations in which our expectations are challenged. And it may be, you know, something just doesn't go the way that we thought it was going to. And we invested ourselves. We invested our faith. We invested our money. We invested our time. We even stood up and said stuff in front of people and declared these things that were going to happen. And it just didn't turn out that way. And that can be offensive, like, God, you left me hanging. You know, I went out on a limb for you. You know, I stood in front of people, and, you know, you have really embarrassed me. You've made me look bad. Have you ever felt that way? It's very possible for that to happen. But yet, Naaman humbled himself and accepted what God had for him, and as a result, he was healed. You see, he had expectations. One version of the Bible says, I thought, and then he said, I expected things to go a certain way. Thoughts lead you to expectations. And when expectations fail and our imagination fails, it's a good chance to get disappointed. You know, how many of you discovered marriage to be different than you imagined? I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand who said that. You're a brave person, whoever that was, but I mean, I really thought you'd have enough sense not to say amen out in public, but Bob is just looking down. He ain't saying nothing. And Linda's smacking him. I heard the smack over there. Like, well, it goes both ways, doesn't it? It's not just the man's expectation, but the, I mean, we just have this picture of what it's going to be like, what he's going to be like, what she's going to be like. And then there's some things that are maybe a little different, you know. And the fellow married this woman, and he got her, it was her honeymoon night, and she took her wig off and took off her false eyelashes and took her teeth out. And took. She wasn't nearly the woman that he thought that he married, you know. That can happen in life, false expectations. And it can set us up for an offense. Or maybe, I remember years ago I just had to have a motorhome. God had challenged me to start traveling more. So I thought, well, if I'm going to have to travel more, I'm going to have my family with me. And so I found this motorhome. It was a cream puff, you know. It only had a few thousand miles on it for its age. And it was something I could afford, and I floated alone. And the first trip out, we went to Florida for Christmas, and we spent the night in Red Fox's front yard. You remember the junkyard Red Fox used to have? And we spent the night in his front yard because it broke down. And we finally got it fixed, and we made it back home. And the next trip, I was going across the mountains toward Frostburg, Maryland, and I was going to go down to Kentucky. And out by Frostburg, we just came over this mountain, and I remember Jeannie was laying in the back reading magazines, and she said, this is the way to travel, you know. And just as I come over the mountain, I hear this big explosion, and the whole thing shivers. And I thought, oh my God, I knew what had happened. It blew a rod. I had just enough oomph to get over the hill and coast down. I thought, thank God it said services. And so I just made halfway up the exit ramp. I don't know where those services were, but they weren't anywhere within miles of that place. And here I am out in the middle of the mountains of Western Maryland. And we didn't even have a cell phone back in those days. There was no pay phone around. It was in the middle of the winter. And I'm thinking, oh God, now what? You know, and that motorhome turned out to be the biggest nightmare of my life. I mean, it was a nightmare. And it took me 6 months to find somebody just to bring it home. Jeannie said, what are you going to do with it? I said, well, we could fill it with dirt and put tomatoes in it. You know, I don't know. Said, you always wanted a home in the mountains. I mean, there you go. But we finally got a new engine in it, and You know, then my car started having trouble. One day this friend of mine came through. He said, I used to have a motorhome, and I laid hands on it, and I released it to the next, because I've been trying everything to get rid of. I went down and said, I release you to your next owner in Jesus' name. And about a week later, this guy called, and he said, are you the guy with a motorhome for sale? Yeah. He said, I want to look at that thing. You're kidding. Hell yeah. So we get out, and he's driving down the road. He said, I don't know why I'm doing this, he said. He said, this is not a good time for me to be buying. And I never did tell him why, because I was afraid if I said, well, God's making you do it, he'd have said, well, that the deal's off then. So I just kept my mouth shut, and I was delivered from that thing. See, my expectation of that motorhome was us driving down the road as a family and having wonderful times and, you know, just, and it was the biggest nightmare of our lives, you know. Things don't always work out the way you think they're going to. You know, and I remember when we tried to go, you know, we tried to go back and actually take the rental car back that we had to rent so we could get home. And that trip, we got home and our well had gone dry. And I mean, it was just one thing after another. And we're sitting in a, because there's a blizzard going on, we can't get over there to Western, you know, where we need to go. And I'm talking to the guy at the garage. He said, oh, he says, yeah, he said the motor's shot, but I got good news. I got a new motor for you, and it's only going to cost you something like, back in those days, like $3,000. It was more than I paid for the motorhome, you know, and I just like, God, what are you doing to me? You know, I just felt like quitting. I mean, it was just like one thing after another, and then this little voice spoke in my, just you know, how do you ever have God speak to you? This little voice said, what are you, a man or a mouse? Yeah, what an offensive thing to say to my friend. I felt like just hanging myself on the cord of the payphone, you know, like, you know, what are you, a man or a mouse? Bless God. I went in and told Jeannie, I said, guess what I just heard? And she, we both broke out laughing. It was people probably thought we were crazy. It was just hysterical. And we got the victory through that, you see. And everything began to change because the word of the Lord to us earlier that year was, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. You know, and everything that the enemy tried to do to destroy us and sideline us, it was horrible, but it never worked. And we kept going. Life can get in your face. It can make us angry. It makes us feel like quitting. There used to be a TV show called Father Knows Best. Anybody remember Father Knows Best? You know, and you know, today Father has made the butt of jokes and to be ridiculous. In fact, parents in general, you know, is to be made ridiculous. All the heroes are kids. You know, that's why we gave them the vote at 18. What a bunch of numbskulls came up with that idea. But if you're 18, I'm sorry, but you know, when you're 18, you think you've got it together. Talk to me when you're 30 and you'll tell me, you know, when I was 18, I thought, see, I don't know anything. I used to know a lot of stuff, but the older I get, the less I know. So if that should tell you anything, be careful who you vote for. It doesn't always turn out the way you think. For those of you that voted for the last big change, I'd like to ask you, how's that working out, by the way? All right. Why shouldn't we become angry? You see, when things... Well, because if we do, we're tempted to put our own thoughts and our own imaginations and our own way into the mix instead of God's. And if we could have fixed it ourselves to begin with, we wouldn't have needed to go to God, would we? If we got to handle it on our own, we'd have no need for God or the ministry. We could just do it ourselves. But we can't. And so, listen, maybe our earthly fathers don't always make the wisest decisions. And I know as a father, I probably didn't either. There's some things I had to go back and repair in my relationship with my son. But our Father in heaven knows best, for sure. And even though it may seem that he's being offensive or that he's let you down, you may discover that in reality he hasn't. In this story, there was another person that got offended. It wasn't the prophet. He just sat in his house and gave the word, but it was his servant Gehazi. See, he'd been serving Elisha for all these years, and I'm sure that the pay that he got wasn't great. And here's this guy shows up with all this gold, all this silver, all these expensive clothing. There it was, you know, and Elisha said, hey, you know, hey, it's not time to get an offering. You know, this is not about us. This is not about you and me. This is about God and him. And so he let him go away, and the guy says, I'm not going to have any of that. You know, I deserve something. I've been serving this guy for all these years, and that's offensive to me that he would just let, what about me? What about my needs? And he chases him down and ends up going away with about 150 pounds worth of silver and some brand new duds. You know, I don't know how much 150 pounds worth of silver is, but I know that 1 ounce of silver right today is worth, what, about $17? You know, so you do the math. I mean, that's a lot of money. And so he comes back, and Elisha said, where you been? Oh, just out and about. He said, didn't you know my spirit went with you? Didn't I tell you it wasn't a time to get an offering? He said, well, you got the offering, but you got something else as well. You got his leprosy. Not only that, it's going to be on your family forever. Wow. See, we have to be careful when we're in the ministry too, that we don't take offense at the way people treat us, or that when things don't turn out the way we thought we were going to, and we invest our life into a project or a program or a church or a people, and it just blows up in our face. I've often said the ministry would be a great job if it weren't for people. Wouldn't it? Just you and Jesus and the Holy Ghost? And, I mean, you know. But see, we're the fly in the ointment, aren't we? If there's going to be trouble, it's going to come from because of us and our things that we do and think and say and how we let one another down. And but when we're in the ministry especially, we have to be careful that we don't take offense. And so we live in a litigious time when people will sue you for anything just because they think they can get some money out of it. And there's lawyers that just have made a fortune on somebody else's misery. I mean, do you know anybody that doesn't make mistakes? I mean, have you never made a mistake? I thought I made a mistake once, and then I found out later that I was mistaken. But, so I guess that was a mistake, but you don't believe that, do you? I've made a lot of mistakes, and I'm glad that every mistake I made didn't turn out in a lawsuit or this or that, but I'm sure that my life has offended people. I've even had people come up to me and say, I don't like you. And I look at them like, what's your problem? Like, how could you not like me? I mean, I'm pretty, can you imagine nobody not liking you, Bob? I mean, you're one of the greatest guys I know. To say, for somebody to say, I don't like that Bob, like, what is your problem, man? You must be sick. Bob's a great guy. But you know, sometimes we offend people by the things we say. I've probably offended somebody here this morning. But my word to you is get over it. Because eventually we have to. You see, the church is so worried about offense that in some places we've been over backwards to push the Holy Ghost out of the room. And to relegate him into some corner somewhere where he's not a threat to us. Because, you know, you never know what the Holy Ghost might do. Right. I remember the first time that I gave a message in tongues. It was Sunday night at the Assemblies of God Church down in West Palm Beach, Florida. The night before, I had spoken in tongues for the first time, and I was pretty excited about that, and God just filled me, and I gave this message in tongues, and the pastor gave the interpretation. I thought, wow, this stuff is real. One of the elders came up afterwards and said, you need to slow down. He said, we had Baptists here tonight, and you offended them. And I just looked at him like, I couldn't figure, you know, slow down. He says, you're going to burn out. And I remember going out. I said, I'd rather burn out than rust out. I'm going on with God. You see, you know, he was offended because I moved in the Spirit in a Pentecostal church. Like, you're watching him all the time like a hawk. Don't let Uncle Louie alone, you know. What's he doing now? That's the way we treat the Holy Ghost in some churches, because we're afraid that God, I mean, the Holy Ghost is God, right? You know, that God will offend somebody. And so we want to protect people because we don't trust God, the Holy Ghost, because actually, if the truth were known, he probably has offended us at some time. And we need to get over it. Maybe we needed to be offended. Jesus sometimes seemed to go out of his way. Lord, you offended them. Don't you know that you've offended the Pharisees? And, you know, he didn't seem to be too concerned about it. He didn't like people that were hypocrites, did he? He was kind to sinners, prostitutes and drunks and tax collectors. But if he was a religious hypocrite, he'd call you things like a whitened sepulcher full of dead man's bones and snakes in the grass and things like that. I mean, kind, inoffensive speech, you know, that he would use. And we worry about being politically correct. Hello? You know, and naming certain people and categorizing people. And you shouldn't categorize people. Really? Yeah, I mean, we shouldn't even have male and female anymore. We should just all use the same bathroom.
We do here.
Do you? Well, yeah, here you do, yeah. Yeah, way ahead of your time. Yeah, yeah, there you go. Well, there you go then. Yeah, I'm not offended because I've used both of them. I want to give equal opportunity. But you see, we're just so concerned about that we've lost the ability to be real. We've lost the ability to really flow in the Spirit. I know that this message is probably for other churches than this one, because you are ahead of the curve on a lot of things. But we need to pray for the church, for its leaders. We need to pray for these churches that have, in a sense, shut God out. Ninth chapter of John is all about the story of the blind man. You know, Jesus comes up to this man who is, the Bible says, blind from birth. You know, and his disciples, being trying to appear spiritual, says, Lord, who sinned, him or his parents? And I'm not sure how much trouble you can get into when you're in your mother's womb, but apparently they thought you were capable of sinning in there because he was born blind. Or maybe on the way out he said something or thought something he shouldn't have, and it caused him to be blind. I'm not sure. But, you know, somehow they attributed his state of trouble to somebody's sin. And, you know, it's very often that we have trouble, and this has nothing to do with sin. It's just life, isn't it? People are born into circumstances of which they have no control. It just happens. And so this poor blind man, I'm wondering how many times in his life he's heard this conversation, because it was common in that day to just assume that if you had some kind of a problem, well, there's sin somewhere. In fact, you know, there's a lot of people today that have that very same attitude. Believe you me, that wasn't just a problem of Jesus' day. There's a lot of people now, if they see somebody having troubles and problems, the back of their mind, they wonder, well, I wonder what they've been up to. Hello? Am I right or am I wrong? And so Jesus said, you've got it wrong. This has nothing to do with sin. This is an opportunity where God's fixing to show his glory here. And now this guy had been blind all his life. His hearing was pretty sharp. He's listening to this conversation, right? Now, all of a sudden, he hears this noise. of a sudden this wet, gooey stuff is smeared all over his eyes. I mean, you talk about offensive. Hello? Talk about offensive. And then this voice speaks to you and says, go wash your face at the pool Siloam. Now, we don't know where that pool was. He might have been sitting right next to it. Might have been on the other side of town. But Jesus didn't say, John, you're the disciple of love. Walk him over there and help him get his face washed. He just said, get over there and wash your face. And he could have been really offended at that. Like, here I am blind. Everybody's wondering whether it's my sin or my parents. And now you come and spit, make mud and smear it all over my eyes. Who do you think you are? But he just went. The Bible says he came away seeing. You know, he didn't let that offense, that offensive thing that happened to him, stop him from getting his healing. There was another group time when Jesus did that with, he just put saliva in the man's eyes, no mud. And actually those two guys got together one time. You didn't probably hear about that, but they were discussing their healing, and the guy says, well, you know, Jesus just spit in my eyes and I was healed. The other guy says, oh, no, no, no. He says, he puts mud, spit in the mud. He said, that's what happened to me. He said, no, 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 just spit. No, no, mud. And that was the beginning of the Muddites and the anti-Muddites. That was a denomination. Two denominations were born. Yeah. That's about the way it happens, isn't it? You know, so. Hallelujah. Born out of a move of God. So, you know, sometimes what we know, see, these disciples figured they knew what was going on. See, what we know sometimes can get in the way of what we need to know. I was down in Guatemala a number of years ago praying for this group of leaders in Antigua, and there was probably 50 or 60 people at the altar, and I'm just going down and praying for each one and just praying for whatever they need. And this little lady was there, a little Guatemalan sister, and the interpreter said she's in terrible pain. She's had pain for years. She's been to the doctors. They can't help her. And so, well, then I'm just going to do what I know to do, right? Pray the prayer of faith, probably just like you would. But as I started to pray for her, all of a sudden I heard these words in my mind. There's no sense in wasting your time praying for her. She's in the hands of the tormentor because she has unforgiveness in her heart. You know, I'd never heard that over anybody in my life. I mean, I know that scripture's in the Bible, but I never really saw it in an application like that. And so I asked the interpreter to ask her if that was true, and she admitted that it was. And so I said, well, I believe God is saying, if you'll just forgive, he'll heal you. Are you willing? And she said, yes. And before I could even touch her, the power of God went through her and set her free. You see, that's what I'm talking about. Sometimes what you know gets in the way of what you need to know. You know, because really, in reality, we don't know much. We think we do. We've studied, we've read, we've had some encounters, but there's a whole lot that we don't know, that we need to know. And so here was this guy, and it stirred up a whole stream of offense, didn't it? Because now all the other religious people were saying, is that him or is that? And the other guy said, yeah, this is me, I'm the one. And they were mad because Jesus did it on a Sabbath day. It's like, you know, we don't really care whether you were blind all your life and now you're seeing. That's not the point. The point here is that the way this was done is not right. And so, and they brought the parents in, and they threatened because they were afraid, because whoever sided with Jesus was threatened to be excommunicated from the church. And they get into all this religious discussion, and now the religious people are getting offended because they're saying, how could this man heal you on a Sunday? He said, well, or a Saturday. He said, well, I don't really know, but he says, I know this, I was blind and now I see. And when in all of our history has anybody ever opened the eyes of anyone who was born blind? He said, God wouldn't listen to a sinner. I mean, and these guys are saying, are you preaching to us, you who were born in iniquity? I mean, like, offense. And Jesus finally revealed himself, I'm the one. He says, you're healed because you were blind. They're not healed because they think they see, and they're guilty because they really don't see. See, offense will make you blind. But the trouble is it makes you think you're seeing, because you get all, you're offended on the inside. You're not thinking right. Your spirit's not right. You're shutting yourself off from the input, the spiritual input that you need. When I was a pastor, someone would come to me and say, you know, I'm just not being fed here anymore. And I'd think to myself, well, who you been criticizing? See, when you stop being fed by the church you're in, there's a good opportunity. It's either one of two things. Either they've gone off to the side and they're no longer preaching the gospel, which is a valid point, or it could be that you've been offended and now you're critical. So you stopped being able to receive sustenance from the Word of God. It cuts you right off. Now, that might be offensive for me to say that to you, but you got to get over it, because God doesn't want you to be in that place. He wants you to grow. And, you know, we need to be gracious as people of God. I love to be merciful to people for the simple reason, if I give mercy, I get mercy. And I'll be the first to admit that I burn up a lot of mercy in my life. And I'm always looking for a chance to refill my mercy tank. Hello? And so we need to be quick to forgive, to give people the benefit of the doubt. Most sins are covered by love. And the ones that aren't, we can go personally and say, you know, when you said that, that really hurt my feelings. You know, and can we make this right? And, you know, there's steps to go through, but most people, when they get offended, they take it in, they nurse it, then they leave bitter. That's not God's plan. That's not kingdom living. That doesn't cause the gospel to grow and the kingdom to grow in the earth. We need to get over ourselves. Now, there's another aspect to this where we can cause people to be offended ourselves. Jesus in Luke 17 said, temptations, some verses use the word offenses, snares, traps set to entice to sin are sure to come. But woe to him by or who through them or by through whom they come. Be better for them never to have been born or to have a millstone around their neck and thrown in the sea than to cause a little young Christian to stumble into sin. And so we need to pay attention. I remember years ago, one of the things that the devil used to use with me to keep me out of church was, well, hypocrites are in church. Look at them. You know, I remember when I was just a young fella and we lived by the railroad track in this little town in Indiana. And right up down the street, it was like a coal yard and stuff, and trains were coming in and going, big, you know, and there was a little gum machine in there, and sometimes I'd have a penny or two for gum, and I'd go in there and get that. And this one time, I remember walking in, and there was a group of railroad guys standing in there just talking, and this one fellow was telling this joke. You know, probably kind of, you can imagine the kind of joke it was he was telling amongst other railroad guys. And it's not that I'd never heard those kind of things before. And maybe trying to appear cool, I might have even told a few myself. But this guy was my Sunday school teacher. When he looked down and saw me, he recognized me. But he was halfway through his joke, you see, and he had to continue on with it. Well, I never said anything to him. Never mentioned it to him. He never mentioned it to me. But something turned inside of me. And then I went to a church, and I grew up a lot of my life in Maine, in this little village up there called Herman, Maine. And everybody knew everybody. And I'd go in on Sunday morning and look at all these people that I knew what they was doing the night before. their lives, how they lived. And here they were in church. In fact, I knew how I was living. I wasn't really living, didn't have the power of God in my life. And here we all were, singing songs, listening to the Bible. And so it began to build a case in my heart that it wasn't real. And so when we offend people, we need to be careful, because we can be a part of the process that leads them away from God. And you might think, well, they just need to get over that. No, we need to stop doing it. Sure, they're going to have to get over it somewhere along the line. Someone once told me, well, if there's hypocrites between you and God, then, you know, you got a problem, because that hypocrite's closer to God than you are. I thought, well, I never thought about it that way. That made sense, you know. So if you got somebody between you and God, you know, maybe they were wrong, but you need to get by it, to forgive them. Get back in line and just be careful that you're not one yourself. We need to open up our doors to the Holy Ghost. We need the Holy Ghost more in this time and age, in our land, in our country, I think, than we ever have for a long time. We've been in tight spots before. We've been in times when the nation was on the verge of splitting, and I think we're living in a terrible, divided time right now in our history. I mean, there's a war, there's a civil war going on all around us. Maybe it's not of bullets and things like that yet. But I'm telling you, people are getting mad at one another, when we need the Holy Spirit to bring us together. He's the common denominator. I mean, the reason that we can tolerate one another and love one another and like one another is because of the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, we'd be mad at each other all the time and living our own selfish lives. We need the Holy Ghost. We need His ministry. We need His unifying effect. We can't do without it. We can't have church without the Holy Ghost. We need the gifts of the Spirit in our life. We need to be moving in the power of God. We need to be speaking in tongues, pressing into God and allowing the Holy Ghost to flow through us and doing miracles and touching people's lives and speaking reality. We need that more than ever. And if someone's going to get offended at it, then just remember they got offended at Jesus too. Even his own family was offended. Even his own mother was offended at him. His brothers came and said, "You're crazy." God help us to not worry about being politically correct. Let's be kingdom correct. To do things out of love and the anointing of God. Amen?
Amen.
Is there anybody here this morning that you've never experienced the baptism of the Holy Spirit? You don't speak in tongues, but you know you're a Christian. You love God. You know who the Holy Spirit is. You wouldn't have come to Christ without Him. It's not like He's a mystery person, but there's more to being a Christian than just getting saved. There's that clothing that He offers to us. Jesus said, "Wait in Jerusalem till you're endued, till you're clothed with the Holy Ghost, and you'll have power to be My disciples. Power to be martyrs," He said, really was the word that He used, to not live just for yourself, but to give your life over to Him in power. And He's here this morning. And if you need His power, He'll give it to you. He wants you to have it, because He knows you need it to accomplish what He's called you for, what He's birthed you for. And you've been birthed into a time of great opportunity to spread the kingdom. People don't know where they're going. They're confused. They're fearful. And they're hearing all kinds of stories. God has the answer for them. So if you're here this morning and you need the power of God in your life, just wave your hand at me. We're going to pray for you. God wants to baptize you this morning. Yes, brother. Anybody else? Will you volunteer in Him? Yeah. It's too late, I think. He's already been poured on. All right, anybody else that you need the baptism of the Holy Spirit? You need to be able to speak in tongues and whatever else God has. Someone said, "Well, do I have to speak in tongues?" And, well, no, but you get to. We used to say it's like getting a pair of shoes, you know, the tongues comes with it. Remember us saying that years ago? You never said, "Oh, yeah." We used to say, "Well, You know, when you get a pair of shoes, you don't get the shoes and you go and get a buy the tongue somewhere else. They come with it, you know. So they're there for you. They're there for a benefit for you so that you, when you pray in tongues, it's like the best cell phone you ever had. And living around here, that ain't saying much. Never seen such poor cell phone service. But I mean, not only can I reach out and touch somebody, I can reach out and touch heaven when I pray in tongues. I mean, it's like instantaneous communication with God. In fact, I've even seen people come to the Lord because I spoke in tongues. A few years ago, a friend of mine down in West Palm, he said, Dennis, you know, you were here a few years ago and you were praying for somebody at the altar, and we had a fellow there from China. And you weren't praying for him. He was sitting right on watching you. And he said, you were praying for that person in his native dialect from the village where he grew up. And God was talking to him through you. And he got saved because of that. I didn't even know that was. He came back a few years later and asked for Dennis. Was Dennis DeGrasse still around? He told my friend the story and he told it to me. I thought, wow. See, you never know what's happening when you're moving in the Spirit. We need to do it more. We need the Holy Ghost because it's through him that we're going to manifest the kingdom of God. So, brother, would you like us to pray for you this morning for that? Come right up here, sir. Now, who's got faith to believe with me for this brother to receive the baptism? Then you come up and stand with me too. What's your name, brother?
John.
Do I know you, John?
Certainly you know me.
You look familiar.
You've never seen me before, but you know me.
All right. Well, your face looks familiar to me. You look sort of like somebody else I know, but that's all right. Well, John, that's a good name, my brother. John, you know Jesus as your Savior?
I do.
Yes. Well, this gift is for believers. And so, John, as we pray for you, now tell me how you received Jesus. Did you have to jump through a lot of hoops, or did you just say, Lord? And then he was there, wasn't he? Well, the Bible says that's the same way you receive the Holy Ghost. There's no working at it. It's just you ask him to do it, he's done it, and we're just going to lay our hands on you. Often it happens that way. And you may get a sensation. Some people have a lot of different experiences, but then some people have none. But it's not about the experience. It's about what God's going to do in your life. And when we do this, it's going to happen, isn't it? And then when it does, you're going to have this heavenly language that's inside of you that you're going to be able to release and talk to God. And, you know, if sometimes people are nervous about doing that in front of people, and I understand that. But it doesn't really matter. You don't need to do it to satisfy me that you've received. And so if you're nervous about doing it here, you know, but if you're not nervous, let her go. Are you ready, brother? Lord, we lift our brother John up to you. We thank you for sending him here this morning, that you're going to fill him with your Holy Spirit. John, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, be baptized in the Holy Spirit of God and be filled with his power. Receive all of his gifts. Receive the flow of God in your life in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Thank you, Father, for baptizing John in the Holy Spirit. Shikomara baba hasikala baba kirion riso bilio sincre dara rede de bibibi se te castos es bololo ermonon mide clite custo estor mache claco kerdon yonde mamahata. Fill him, O God, I pray, in Jesus' name. There you go, brother. That's it, man. That's it, brother. Bless you. Keep going. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Praise to the Lord our God. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Amen. Amen. Good work, gang. Good work. Bless you, Brother John. Amen. Be full of God. Hallelujah. That's wonderful. Praise the Lord. Would you like to testify?
I'm good.
Okay, brother. All right. Praise the Lord.
I'm probably as close to God in here as anybody.
There you go. Hallelujah. Well, that was a great finish, wasn't it? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Oh. Hallelujah. Okay. So who's the candidate? Both of you. All right. Come on, gang. Here we go. Come on, gang. Here we go. Brother, you've opened the door. Thank you. What is your name, honey?
Jamie
and Melissa. Well, now you both love Jesus, right? I know that you do. I can tell by the smile on your face. Lord, we just thank you for Jamie and Melissa. Lord, you know which one is which. And Father, I just pray right now, Father, in the Holy Spirit, come. Come upon our sisters. Fill them with your power. Anoint them, God, that they can be spokesmen for you. Give them great boldness and power, that they'll shake the powers of darkness, that wherever they go, they'll challenge the status quo, that you'll speak through them and do things through them, and you'll anoint their hands to do miracles. In Jesus' name, Lord. Fill them up with your power. Yeah, be full. Be full of God. Be full of the power of God. Be full of his anointing. Be baptized in Jesus' holy name. In Jesus' holy name. In Jesus' holy name. Amen. Yes. Yes. Yeah, now let the, just let that language flow. Shikaraba sakala bahara baba. Shandula da da mama seke. Riso tele da baba kito ke. Biendo merdoso. Rose tele da baba bahata rabaka. Krasu petele de bibi shete. Shumendo ri baba hatai. Pasha kabarutos. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah. All right. Well, are there any more candidates? Are there any more candidates for the Holy Ghost? Maybe some of these young people here, you know, you don't have to be old to get the Holy Ghost. Get him when you're young. Put your life in his hands when you're young. He likes to fill little children with his power. So, hallelujah. You going to get prayed for, my brother? All right. Hallelujah. Yes. Come on, gang. We're not done. Gather around here. Come on. Brother, you come up and pray with us, too. Come on. Yes. Hallelujah. What's your name, my brother?
Mark.
Mark, I know you love Jesus. Yeah. Father, we just thank you for Mark. We thank you for your power coming on Mark. Oh, come, Holy Ghost, and fill him. Come, Holy Ghost, and anoint him. Mark, be full of the Holy Ghost. Be it baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let her go. Riso karidonos. Riso keminete. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Be full of the Holy Ghost of God. Pico do rico padete, panyara da babahata. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Bless you. Bless you. All right. All right, gang. All right. Hallelujah. Well, listen, don't forget the books. I don't want to see any books on that table when I go by. I got cases at home.
Wow.
Hallelujah.
That was good. That was good. For those of you that were prayed for, and for those of you that might have just been sitting there going, man, I want that, but I don't think I'm going to go up front. I just say that